hip joint is a ball and socket type of joint. It is multi-axial joint and it is designed for stability and weight bearing. The articulating surfaces are the head of femur and the acetabulum, and the capsule of hip joint attaches to the edge of the acetabulum and to the intertrochanteric line on the femur anteriorly and posteriorly. There are two kinds of ligaments here, intracapsular and extracapsular. There are two intracapsular ligaments, ligament of head of femur and the transverse acetabular ligament, which bridges the acetabular foramen. There are three extracapsular ligaments. The first one is pubofemoral, which spans between superior pubic rami and the intertrochanteric line of femur. It is triangular in shape and it prevents over abduction and extension of the hip joint. The next one is the ischiofemoral ligament, which lies between the body of ischium and the greater trochanter. It is chiral in shape. The third ligament is iliofemoral, which is the strongest ligament of all of them. It starts from the anterior superior iliac spine to the intertrochanteric line, and all the ligaments prevent hyperextension of the hip joint. Next is the vascular supply. The main vessel here is the deep femoral or profunda femoris artery, which gives off two major branches, medial circumflex femoral and lateral circumflex femoral. Medial circumflex femoral in turn gives four retinacular arteries, superior, inferior, anterior, and posterior, while lateral circumflex femoral artery gives three branches, ascending, descending, and transverse. All these branches anastomose around the neck of the femur. The other major arteries here are artery to head of femur, superior and inferior gluteal artery. These are the dermatomes of hip joint. The medial portion of the hip joint is supplied by the obturator nerve. The anterior and lateral portion is by the femoral nerve. The nerve roots here are L2, L3, L4. Lateral femoral cutaneous is a purely sensory nerve which supplies the lateral portion of the thigh. The sciatic nerve supplies the posterior portion of the joint and the thigh. Osteotomes. Femoral nerve supplies the anterior portion of the neck of femur, the base of greater trochanter, and the anterior shaft of the femur. Obturator nerve supplies the medial portion of head of femur and the medial shaft of femur, while sacral plexus gives innervation to the posterior portion of the head and shaft of femur. For the sake of convenience and understanding, the hip joint is divided into different quadrants, that is superolateral, inferolateral, superomedial, inferomedial quadrant. Here GT represents greater trochanter, LT represents lesser trochanter, and AIIS is the anterior inferior iliac spine. The major myotomes that we are going to discuss today are tensor fascia lata, gluteus maximus, gluteus medius minimus, and external rotators of the hip joint, which are involved in hip flexion, extension, and external rotation. This is a picture of the major muscles of hip joint. Here you can see the iliopsoas muscle and the adductor muscles. Here you can see various different muscles. We begin from the tensor fasciae lata. This is the tensor fasciae lata. The next one is the gluteus maximus muscle, which originates from ilium and inserts into the greater trochanter. Next is the gluteus medius and minimus, which also begin from the ilium and insert on the greater and lesser trochanter respectively. The other muscles are piriformis, superior gemelli, obturator internus, inferior gemelli, and anteriorly there is quadratus femoris muscle. The common hip surgeries that are performed on hip joint are hip arthroplasty, maybe partial or total, proximal femur nailing, and dynamic hip screw insertion. For arthroplasty, there are three types of incisions that are taken. The first one is the anterior incision, which begins 2 to 4 cm lateral to ASIS. The main myotomes involved here are tensor fascia lata, sartorius, rectus femoris, and gluteus medius. The next one is the lateral incision, which begins proximal to GT and extends 5 to 8 cm distal to the greater trochanter. Here, the main myotomes involved again are tensor fascia lata and all the three glutei muscles, maximus, medius, and minimus. And the third one is the posterior incision, which begins 5 cm distal to the greater trochanter, and it curves posteriorly towards the posterior superior iliac spine. It is almost 6 cm in length. Here, the main muscles involved are the external rotators of the hip joint. This is the incision for proximal femur nailing. As you can see, the incision is in line with the shaft of femur and begins quite proximally to the greater trochanter. Next, we discuss about the nerve supply of the hip joint. Bimbam et al. Showed that the major nerves involved here in the hip joint innervation are derived from the lumbosacral plexus. The main nerves of interest here are femoral nerve and obturator nerve. Femoral nerve supplies mainly the anterolateral quadrant of the capsula, and obturator nerve supplies the anteromedial capsule. Other innervations are from sacral plexus, which give supply to the posterior and inferior capsule. They said that the mechanoreceptors are present in the posterior-inferior part of the capsule and nociceptors are present in the anterior and superolateral part of the capsule. Femoral nerve and obturator nerve may be the primary mediators of nociceptive pain from the hip joint, thus narrowing the focus of regional anesthesia. However, blockade of the sacral plexus is necessary to provide surgical anesthesia. A study was done by Short et al. On the anatomic study of on the anatomy of innervation of the anterior hip capsule, which was published in Regional Anesthesia and Pain Medicine. They described femoral nerve as arising from the dorsal division of the lumbar plexus L2, L3, L4. It divides into anterior and posterior divisions. When it gives branches above the inguinal ligament, they are called as high branches. And when it branches below the inguinal ligament, it is called as low branch. High branches supply the superolateral, inferolateral, and superomedial quadrants, while low branches supply the inferolateral quadrant of the hip joint. This is a cadaveric dissection study which shows both high and low branches, and this red square is the area of interest, that is the area supplied by the femoral nerve. The next one is the obturator nerve, which arises from anterior rami of L2, L3, L4. It passes under the iliac vessels, as you can see in the cadaveric diagram here, and it aligns with the pelvic wall, enters the obturator foramen, and it is accompanied by the obturator neurovascular bundle. It bifurcates into anterior and posterior branches. This bifurcation takes place most commonly within the obturator canal, but it could be intrapelvic or at the level of medial thigh. It also gives high and low branches. High branches supply the inferomedial quadrant, while low branches supply the inferolateral quadrant. This is the cadaveric diagram of high and low branches of obturator nerve, and the area of interest is shown by the square box. In 20% people, accessory obturator nerve is present for the blood supply, for the nerve supply to the hip joint. And it is formed from L2 to L5 lumbar nerves. It courses deep to the psoas, crosses over the iliopubic eminence, and terminates on the capsule of the hip joint. It also innervates mainly the medial quadrant of the capsule. In 7 specimens, they found that the major supply was to the inferomedial quadrant, but 5 specimens, they found that it was to the superomedial quadrant. The next one is the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, which is a purely sensory branch, arises from L2 and L3 posterior divisions of the lumbar plexus. It again divides into anterior and posterior divisions and mainly supplies the skin of anterior and lateral thigh. There can be variations in the origin of lateral femoral cutaneous nerve. It may arise from L1, L2, or it may also arise directly from the femoral nerve. The next one is the superior gluteal nerve, which arises from the dorsal divisions of L4, L5, S1. It innervates the gluteus medius muscle, gluteus minimus muscle, and tensor fascia lata. It exits the greater sciatic foramen above the piriformis, goes on to supply these muscles, and it also divides into superior and inferior branches. The next nerve is the inferior gluteal nerve, which exits the pelvis below the piriformis, and it lies close to the sciatic nerve. It doesn't give any cutaneous branches. The major muscle it supplies is gluteus maximus muscle. It ramifies and supplies to the capsule of the hip joint after supplying gluteus maximus muscle. These are my references. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you, Roma. I think she tried covering all aspects and all myotome, dermatome, osteotomes. And we'll first finish with the presentations of all three candidates. So, Namrata, are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please start your presentation.
Okay. Am I audible? Is my screen visible, sir?
Yeah, please start.
Okay. So, regional anesthesia and analgesia strategies for hip surgery. So, we'll go further with the what are the options available for us for regional anesthesia for hip surgeries. So, as traditionally described, the central neuraxial blockade, which we perform spinal anesthesia and epidural anesthesia. Then there is lumbar sacral plexus block. Then there are some proxy lumbar plexus block, that is anterior quadris lumborum block or lumbar erector spinae block. Sciatic nerve block as such, not only given for hip surgery, it is always in the combination with the lumbar plexus blocks. Then there is supra-inguinal fascia iliaca block, lateral femoral cutaneous nerve block, fascia iliaca infra-inguinal block, femoral nerve block, which we have traditionally practiced since years, and obturator nerve block. However, there are new upcoming blocks which need randomized control trials, and they are still in research, which are PENG block, iliopsoas plane block, and clunial nerve block. So, anatomy as it is described by Dr. Roma, I will not go in detail. Lumbar and sacral plexus block is formed from ventral rami of L1 to L4 and all the nerve and posterior divisions of L2, L3, L4 forms the femoral nerve, whereas anterior divisions of the L2, L3, L4 forms the obturator nerve, and in some patients there is also some person's accessory obturator nerve is also formed. Supply, the sensory osseous distribution is already covered, so I'll skip this part. Let's get to the lumbar plexus block first. So to the history, if we see, Pinney's described first the anterior approach for blocking the lumbar plexus in 1973. Then Vinnie himself described the posterior approach in 1974. Whereas in 1976, Chayan described it as psoas compartment block. After only Kirchmer studied in 2001, it was shown that there is no compartment as such. It is not in the compartment. It is within the muscle, the lumbar plexus lies. Parkinson et al. Gave the approach of a posterior lumbar plexus block in 1989, whereas Captivilla modified the Vinnie's approach in 2002 for landmark guided insertion of needle. This is a schematic diagram at the L4 level of lumbar vertebra, and this is the transverse anatomy of the lumbar paravertebral region. So just to describe the anatomy, lumbar plexus is an intramuscular facial compartment, not between the psoas muscle and quadratus lumborum, which was earlier described, but it is inside the psoas major muscle between the anterior two-thirds and the posterior one-third of the psoas muscle portions. So the anterior two-thirds of the psoas muscle is arising from the vertebral body, anterolateral surface of the vertebral body, whereas the posterior one-third of the psoas muscle arises from the transverse fossa, which is not seen here, which is sandwiched between the anterior two-third and the posterior one-third of the lumbar plexus. There is also a lumbar paravertebral space in which there are lumbar veins and lumbar arteries and lumbar nerve roots just arise from the lumbar paravertebral space. It is just close to the vertebral body. So we'll go to the landmark and PNS guided technique to lumbar plexus block, which is traditionally followed. Patient is in the lateral decubitus position as described here. Foot on the side to be blocked will be on the upper side so that we can see the quadriceps muscle contraction easily. Landmarks will be marked first on the back of the patient's skin. That is one line going through the spinous processes, one line going through the posterior superior iliac spine of the ipsilateral side, one line perpendicular going through the iliac crest. The needle insertion point is described between the junction of the medial two-third and the lateral one-third of the line between spinous process of the L4 vertebra and the line parallel to the spinal column, which is passing through the PSIS. The needle is inserted at the perpendicular angle, not medially inclined or not laterally inclined. It is inserted till the quadriceps muscle contractions are visible. Current should be always sought less than 0.5, as less than 0.5 milliampere current is it could be inside the dural sleeve, and the injection could be inside the intrathecal space or epidural space. There are different approaches of needle insertion described in the articles. Vinny's approach was needle was inserted at the intersection of the posterior superior iliac spine line and the perpendicular line joining the iliac crest. He had inserted the needle through this intersection with a medial inclination, whereas Chayen has described the needle insertion a little corded, that is 3 cm corded to the L4 vertebral spinous process and 5 cm lateral to that. Then there is decrease approach, which is a more proximal approach, which is at the level of L3 vertebra, and it is 3 to 4 cm lateral to the L3 vertebra. Whereas Capdevila approach, which is usually practiced, is as described before, that is at the junction of the medial two-third and the lateral one-third of the intersection. So what was the limitations of these techniques and why it is replaced by Capdevila's approach? It's basically Vinny's technique used the medial angulation of the needle, which is very difficult to control, and it can lead to epidural and subarachnoid needle insertion. Technique of Chayen is more caudal, but as the L5 transverse process is shortest, the needle may not encounter the bone and it may directly lead into the intrathecal or epidural space. The cranial approach of Tecris, however, is it could prove as injurious to the kidney, and it can cause capsular perforation and hematoma. Also, Capdevila not only gave the approach for the needle insertion today, but he has also studied in 2002 in his study that he used a CT scan of the normal subject, and he found that the plexus to be located 2/3 of the way from the midline to the line to the PSIS. And thus, he advocated this as an entry point for the needle insertion. Also, he found that the needle, lumbar plexus was 18 mm deeper than the transverse process. So when we are using a landmark and PNS guided technique, we should be, after getting the transverse process, after during the needle insertion, we're hitting the transverse process, we should not go beyond 2 cm further. He also found the depth of the lumbar plexus from the skin was in the range of, on an average, 83 mm in men, 71 mm in women. Then there is an era of ultrasound-guided lumbar plexus block technique, which was first USG-guided lumbar plexus block was described by Trident View by Carmichael et al. In 2008. Also, he gave a paramedian transverse scan view in 2015 and the Shamrock method recently described by Axel Sauter. So we'll see this one by one. In ultrasound-guided lumbar plexus block using Trident View, we keep the USG probe. So we choose a curvilinear probe as it is, the structures are deep, and we place the probe in the parasagittal line, that is a paramedian sagittal scan, it is called. Again, the patient will be in the lateral decubitus position and the probe will be in the parasagittal scan. The sonoanatomy picture, what we get is the trident sign. So this is called the trident sign. It is basically the transverse process acoustic shadow are causing the trident sign. The posterior erector spinae muscle we can see the psoas muscle in between the transverse processes. As it is described, lumbar plexus is between the anterior 2/3 and the posterior 1/3. Lumbar plexus will be lying over here. needle will be out of plane and it will be inserted through the intertransverse space until the quadriceps contractions are seen. Then the Karmakar et al. In 2015 modified his technique by paramedian transverse scan. In this, as shown in the diagram, patient is again in the lateral decubitus position, USG machine in the front of the patient, and the operator stands behind the patient. And the probe position is in the paramedian transverse view. So the line, the anatomical landmarks, which we have already marked on the patient's skin, the line going through the spinous process, this is the parasagittal view for the parasagittal ultrasound trident view. The probe will be kept in the transverse manner on the same line with marker lateral. So the what sonoanatomy picture we get is we can see the vertebral body, we can see the transverse process, erector spine in the posterior, quadratus lumborum and psoas major muscle. So this is the scan done in the transverse process at the transverse process level. If we slide the probe little cranial or caudal, we get the intertransverse process view where we can see actually the nerve roots arising and the lumbar plexus will be seen better visualized. It will be better visualized. And the transverse process will be gone, and here we can see the articular process. Needle insertion point will be, it is described as actually from the medial side, and it will be in plane technique until the quadriceps contractions are solved. Shamrock method, as told by Sauter, Axel Sauter, we keep the ultrasound probe, again the curvilinear ultrasound probe, directly in the iliac crest. The sonoanatomy picture, what we get is of that three leaves skein, as we describe it for the quadratus lumborum block as well. So the transverse process of the vertebral, the vertebra, L4 vertebra is seen over here. Psoas major is seen in the anterior part. Quadratus lumborum slip is this attaching to the transverse process. Erector spinae in the posterior part. Vertebral body, as this is the right side, actually this is inferior vena cava. So as we, the lumbar plexus block is a deep block, so it should be always used with color Doppler, power Doppler, confirmed once, and it should be used with PNS. Once the Shamrock view is obtained, again the needle insertion, as described by Shamrock, the needle insertion is still this point, but we follow the technique that the needle insertion will be in line and just besides the probe. Complications of lumbar plexus block, vascular puncture is very much, it can happen because inferior vena cava on the right side, aorta on the left side, dorsal lumbar vessels, ascending lumbar vein, as we seen in the schematic diagram, they are all around in the needle pathway. So it can happen. Hematoma, as it is non-compressible structure, if it occurs, it will be a dreadful thing. There can be nerve injury as we are going to the lumbar spinal nerve roots. Hemodynamic consequences are possible if it is intrathecal or epidural spread. Infection, as we are going deep, we have to follow a strict asepsis during lumbar plexus block. And local anesthesia systemic toxicity is always there with any block. So special considerations during USG guided lumbar plexus block or lumbar paravertebral region is highly vascular. As I said, there are ascending lumbar veins and arteries which should be visualized always with color and power Doppler ultrasonography. One must be cautious with moderate to mild coagulopathy, as hip surgery patients are always on the geriatric population of the patients, they have multiple comorbidities, they are mostly on the anticoagulants. We should always see the benefits versus risk ratio during lumbar plexus blocks. The echo intensity of the skeletal muscles in the old age is increased significantly, and so the hyper echoic structure of the lumbar plexus, it is difficult to visualize because the whole muscle appears hyper echoic sometimes. Also in obese patients, it will be technically difficult to perform. So recent the study was done by Strid et al. For the ultrasound guided lumbar ultrasound trident method and the Shamrock method. He did this study for basically the outcome. Primary outcome was block procedure time. How much time is required for both block was compared. Number of needle insertions were compared. The procedure discomfort was seen. So it was observed that Shamrock method took lesser time than the lumbar ultrasound trident method to visualize the plexus as well as to effectively block the lumbar plexus. Number of needle insertions, as you can see, were less in the Shamrock method, and patient discomfort. The patient discomfort was asked on the NRS units that 0 is minimal discomfort and 10 is the maximal discomfort. And it was seen that it was lesser than the lumbar ultrasound trident method in Shamrock method. This was a study done recently by Pamni and Karmakar et al. Himself in 2018. So he himself actually compared the paramedian transverse scan technique to visualize the lumbar plexus block and the Shamrock scan technique. And they demonstrated actually that lumbar plexus is more frequently visualized and the quality of ultrasound visualization of the lumbar plexus is superior with the Shamrock intertransverse scan than with the paramedian transverse oblique scan, intertransverse. So the actually, it was said that reduced anisotropy is with the Shamrock method is because the ultrasound transducer angle varies with the insonation. So musculoskeletal structures were best visualized with the incident ultrasound beam because it was perpendicular to the lumbar plexus. So it was believed that it was because of the angle of insonation. As you can see, the Shamrock method proved to be better in visualization of the lumbar plexus. So as et al., this is comparatively the old article, 2008, he demonstrated, Ture et al., he demonstrated the efficacy and safety of the lumbar plexus block for hip and knee surgery as well, for the intraoperative as well as the postoperative analgesia technique. So for hip surgery, they didn't found any conclusive evidence that it can be combined, lumbar plexus can be combined with sciatic and can be used as an alternative to GU spinal anesthesia. But for post-operative analgesia, when they compared lumbar plexus block, continuous lumbar plexus block with catheter, with epidural catheter, it was comparable and it was equivalent to the epidural anesthesia. So coming to the sacral plexus block, as described by Benston et al. In 2011, he gives us the parasacral parallel shift method to block sacral plexus.
Namrata, you have now 5-7 minutes.
Yes, sir. So parasacral parallel shift method. He gave he actually put the transducer in between the line posterior superior iliac spine and the greater trochanter. So the probe was kept between the posterior superior iliac spine and the midpoint of the posterior superior iliac spine and the greater trochanter. He identified the iliac balloon, gluteus maximus and medius muscle. Transducer was moved in the same plane with the parasacral parallel shift, where he found the iliac bone was broken and the piriformis muscle was seen. Sacral plexus was just below the piriformis muscle. And the needle was inserted in plane technique. Also, Taha in 2011 has given the better way, according to him, of blocking the sacral plexus, which he said that the probe should be kept 8 cm lateral to the gluteal cleft and directly identify the posterior border of the ischium, and sciatic nerve will be visible or sacral plexus will be visible directly there. So he had actually done the study and we found that in 96% patient, it was identified very successfully and it was identified within just 8 to 13 seconds of the intercontinental range. So he proves that this method of blocking the sacral plexus is better than any other method. Also, he said that internal pudendal vessels and the vessels we should avoid during the sacral plexus block are better seen in this view, and a needle entry will be the out of plane, avoiding this the vessel or nerve trauma. Complications of sacral plexus block: loss to the parasympathetic function to the bowel bladder. Since it is parasympathetic, the sympathetic blockade is not much seen unless it is spread to the lumbar sympathetic fibers by using the excessive volume. The volumes of local anesthetic which we use normally for lumbar plexus block is 25 to 30 ml, and for the sacral plexus block is 15 ml. Depending on the analgesia or anesthesia, it will be 0.25% of propivacaine or 0.5% of propivacaine. Coming to the femoral nerve block, which is also traditionally followed for the hip surgeries. As we all know, below the inguinal ligament, femoral nerve lies lateral to the femoral artery and femoral vein, whereas it lies on the anteromedial aspect of the iliopsoas muscle. Let's not get into much of the anatomy as it is already described. It is supplying sartorius, it is supplying pectineus, and the major quadriceps femoris muscle. hip joint as well as the knee joint. So landmark guided technique, as traditionally followed, we find the pulse, femoral pulse first, femoral arterial pulsations. One thumb kept on the femoral arterial pulsation, 1.5 centimeter lateral, 1.5 centimeter caudal, needle insertion directed to the cranial side until the twitches of the quadriceps muscles are absorbed. Technique USG guided, we directly keep the probe in the inguinal crease and we first try to locate the femoral artery. And we try to locate the fascia iliaca and fascia lata. Fascia lata covering the femoral vessels, whereas fascia iliaca just covering the femoral nerve. Iliopsoas, the femoral nerve lies superomedial to the iliopsoas muscle. So it is actually the femoral nerve is anisotropic in the inguinal region. You need to tilt the probe caudally and cranially to identify the femoral nerve. As it is described triangular in traditional books, but it is not always the case. It could be elliptical, it could be circular. And there is also anatomic variation, which is described by Woodworth G. Et al. That he found, sorry, sir. Okay. He found that the femoral nerve was buried in the iliopsoas muscle rather than in its normal position, that is lateral to the femoral artery. Because he found this one case, he sequentially conducted the study on the 500 patients and he did the MRI scans. And out of 500, seven cases were identified that nerve was actually in the iliopsoas muscle and not above the fascia iliaca, below the fascia iliaca, just lateral to the femoral artery. Also, while doing the scan, we should be very much sure that femoral artery has not given the profunda femoris artery, that is the largest branch of femoral artery, because it is given up much lower and if we block the femoral nerve over here, we are missing out the higher femoral branches, higher articular branches of the hip joint or the nerve supply we want. So we should always scan proximally if we get this picture and then try to identify femoral artery just in itself and then femoral nerve should be blocked. Coming to the fascia iliaca block, fascia iliaca compartment block was initially described by 1989 by Dalens et al. It was used on children's in first. Was given by landmark technique, of course. It is a low skill, inexpensive method actually to attain the anesthesia and analgesia. Nerves targeted are femoral nerve, lateral femoral cutaneous nerve. It is described as obturator nerve, but we'll see in coming slides that whether it blocks or not. Local anesthetic dose uses 25 to 30 ml of 0.25% to 0.5% bupivacaine, as it is a facial plane block. We need to use the larger volume. Anatomy will not go in much detail. As femoral nerve, lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, we know that it is arising from the L2, L3, L4. Within the psoas major muscle, the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve is going up much lateral and at the inguinal ligament insertion, lateral femoral cutaneous nerve comes to lie superficially above the fascia iliaca. So it is very important if we want to block lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, we have to block it above the inguinal ligament because below that it lies superficially and it doesn't lie below fascia iliaca. Femoral nerve, as we see, it comes from lateral to medial to lateral of the psoas major muscle border, and then it lies, of course, lateral to the femoral artery and femoral nerve, femoral vessels. Obturator nerve is much more medial from the start, and it enters the obturator canal and leaves the pelvis. Fascia iliaca is formed by the fascia iliacus muscle anteriorly and fascia iliaca superiorly. Whereas medially, we can see the vertebral column and laterally, it is iliac crest. Landmark technique given by the given for the fascia iliaca block is described traditionally as one finger on the anterior superior iliac spine, one finger on the pubic tubercle. Divide this, draw a line and divide this into one third parts. And we give the injection at the junction of the lateral one third and medial one third, 1 centimeter below the junction actually. And the needle is inserted at the 60-degree angle. Two pops are felt, fascia lata, fascia iliaca, and the injection is given. USG guided infra-inguinal block. So this was when fascia iliaca block was described, USG guided, it was first described as infra-inguinal itself. That we keep the probe in the inguinal crease again as we scan for the femoral nerve block. We scan the same way, just that we come a little lateral and we can see the iliopsoas muscle very clearly and the injection, local anesthetic injection is given just below the fascia iliaca over here. So it is aimed to block femoral nerve as well as laterally the lateral femoral cutaneous. USG guided supra-inguinal fascia iliaca block was first described by Hebbard et al. In 2011, which was modified by Desmet et al. In 2017. So what we do is we keep the probe first in the as we keep it in the inguinal crease transverse direction, and then we keep move the probe clockwise, and it is perpendicular to the inguinal ligament actually. At that point of time, we see sartorius muscle caudally and internal oblique muscle cranially, iliacus muscle below it, and the anterior inferior iliac spine. So aim is to give the injection just above the iliacus muscle at this junction. And if you can see here, the dorsal circumflex iliac artery has to be visualized before giving injection, as we have to avoid the injury as well as it is an anatomical landmark to confirm we are below fascia iliaca. This was a study done by Desmet et al. For the efficacy of the supraingual fascia iliaca compartment block, which has actually given us that it reduces the morphine consumption after total hip arthroplasty. And he assessed the sensory as well as the motor block, which said that 93% of the patient femoral nerve was blocked by sensory assessment, and 76% obturator nerve was blocked, whereas 95% lateral femoral cutaneous nerve was blocked. When he saw the motor blockade, it was also consistent with 88% of the femoral nerve blockade and 86% of the obturator nerve blockade. So this resulted in decreased morphine consumption, and it was proven beneficial, but there were some limitations to the study because assessment of the obturator nerve block was difficult as there is inconsistent cutaneous distribution of the obturator nerve. So they relied on motor function, but again, the motor function is affected as the motor supply to the muscles is also by sciatic nerve and femoral nerve contribution. So we cannot rely on the assessment. Then there came a study of by Chris Vermillion in 2019 about supraingual fascia iliaca, how it is more consistently spreading obturator nerve than towards the obturator nerve than the infrainguinal injection, how it is better. So according to them, supraingual fascia iliaca gave the sensory block of medial anterior and lateral thigh compared to the infrainguinal fascia iliaca block. However, block of obturator nerve was not proven. They just did the Ellis spread study by the MRI CT scans. So as you can see, this is the local anesthesia spread. This is the common iliac artery. According to them, obturator nerve was blocked, but after study by Thomas Penston in 2021, as clearly depicted that the fascia iliaca is in green color, as you can see here, is not covering the obturator nerve because it is lying somewhere in the retropsoas compartment and not the fascia iliaca compartment. So if you can see, the fascia iliaca compartment block will result in the spread of local anesthetic to femoral nerve, to the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, to genitofemoral nerve, and it will stop at the external and internal iliac artery. It will not go beyond. So in this diagram, actually, we can see the local anesthesia spread is stopping over the iliac artery, and the obturator nerve anatomical location is not covered. So yes, there was cadaveric study. The same study was done in cadavers, and methylene blue was injected, and it was seen that the spread is stopping at the internal obturator muscle, but it is not going to the obturator nerve. Also, after lifting up the psoas major, we can see the femoral nerve and the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve or the other branches are blocked just distally. They are not blocked in the psoas compartment by the supraingual fascia iliaca block. So thank you, and further will be continued by Dr. Ankit.
Yes, thank you, Namrata. And we have last presentation to go with Dr. Ankit. Then we'll have discussion. Over to you, Ankit.
Is my presentation visible?
Yeah, please continue.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. Continuing blocking individual nerves that contribute to the innervation of hip joint, let's look at the obturator nerve. It arises from the primary rami of anterior divisions of the lumbar spinal nerves L2, L3, and L4. Of the few landmark-based techniques that have been devised for blocking this nerve, let's look at the classic technique by Labat. The point of needle insertion is 3 cm lateral and caudal to the pubic tubercle. After inserting the needle, contact is made with the inferior border of superior pubic rami at 2 to 4 cm additional depth. Then the needle is withdrawn back to the skin and it is redirected laterally by 45 degrees to enter the obturator canal at an additional depth of 1 to 2 cm. Then the drug is deposited after observing adductor muscle contractions with the peripheral nerve stimulator. Now coming to the ultrasound-guided techniques for obturator nerve block, first we'll be seeing the distal approach in which we block the anterior and posterior branches of the obturator nerve as they run between the adductor longus, brevis, and magnus respectively. Patient is placed supine and we choose a linear probe for common adult population as this is not a deep block. The transducer is placed over the inguinal crease and slid medially. such that we obtain an acoustic window in which the acoustic window that is medial to the femoral vein. The needle is inserted in plane with the transducer in a lateral to medial direction and the drug deposited in the planes between the three muscles or after observing contractions of the adductor muscles on the medial side of the thigh if you're using PNS. Based on evidence reports, literature had started to get dubious if this approach blocked the high articular branches of the obturator nerve or not. So this distal method may be insufficient to block the high articular branches. Later, a more proximal approach was designed in which the idea was to block the common obturator nerve in the canal before it divides into anterior and posterior branches. In this, the transducer is moved a little more medially and tilted slightly cranially from the previous position, and a hyperechoic structure with an acoustic shadow is seen representing the superior pubic rami. The target for injection of local anesthetic is the fascia, which is seen as a contiguous structure with the superior pubic rami and located between the pectineus and obturator externus muscles. This technique was described by Taha and Lin, depending on the approach used for the trajectory of the needle. Taha went by the out-of-plane approach, whereas Lin used the in-plane approach. The vascular marker of concern while giving this obturator nerve block is the medial femoral circumflex artery that originates from the profunda femoris and then runs posteriorly and medially between the pectineus and iliopsoas muscles and further between the obturator externus and adductor brevis to supply the head of femur. So any kind of inadvertent injury to this vessel can lead to avascular necrosis of the head of femur. Most of the times, blockade of the obturator nerve is used as a combination with other techniques. So the total dose of the local anesthetic drugs are shared between the two blocks. But still, since a minimum effective volume needs to be maintained, usually 5 to 10 ml of drug solution is deposited in each plane if you're giving using a distal approach, or 10 to 15 ml of the drug solution is used if you're giving as a proximal single shot injection. Certain complications can happen while giving this block, especially in cases of landmark guided techniques like the classical approach by Labatt, where the needle is inserted blindly. So in inexperienced hands, it can lead to perforation of bladder, rectum, and spermatic cord. It can also result in accidental puncture of the obturator vessels, resulting in intravascular injection or hematoma. Then there is an entity known as corona mortis, which is a retropubic anastomosis between the external iliac vessels and the obturator arteries, but it is seen in only 10% of the population. Any inadvertent puncture to this anastomosis can result in bleeding, but this is very difficult to control. Certain contraindications for giving obturator nerve block include patient refusal, allergy to ileal drugs, perineal infections, pre-existing obturator nerve neuropathy, adductor muscle group paresis, deranged coagulation, or inguinal lymphadenopathy. Now, obturator nerve block has also been a part of various approaches that block a group of nerves combinedly if drug is deposited at a common point or in a common plane in which all the nerves of interest run. So like 3-in-1 block that was described by Vini in 1973, it is a kind of fascia iliaca compartment block or anterior approach to lumbar plexus block. The drug is deposited around the femoral nerve and distal compression was given such that the drug gets dispersed in the plane between the psoas major and the quadratus lumborum. This block involved blockade of femoral nerve, obturator nerve, and lateral femoral cutaneous nerve. And the incidence of blockade of obturator nerve was only 30 to 60%. Next was the iliofacial block that was described by Dallin in 1989. It was also a type of fascia iliaca compartment block, but is a more lateral approach and more successfully used in pediatric patients. But the incidence of obturator nerve block was only 10 to 30%. And then the psoas compartment block which blocks obturator nerve with an incidence of 88 to 93%. Now coming to lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, I'll not deal in detail with the anatomy of this nerve, but I would definitely like to show this image that shows different variations of the relationship of the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve with the inguinal ligament and the anterior superior iliac spine. Now, as we go through the images one by one, first is the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve passes from below the inguinal ligament. Then it might pass through the inguinal ligament. It may pass above the inguinal ligament. It may pass over the anterior superior iliac spine. It may pass behind the anterior superior iliac spine. It may pass through the anterior superior iliac spine, or it may pass through the sartorius muscle. Among all of these, this first one where the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve passes from below the inguinal ligament is the most common variation that comprises almost 87% of the population. Coming to the landmark guided approach for blocking lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, the point of needle insertion is 1.5 centimeter caudal to the anterior superior iliac spine, and the needle is directed at an angle 60 degree to the skin in cephalide direction. The ultrasound guided approach includes using a linear probe as this is a very superficial block, and the probe is kept in a transverse fashion at the same point as with the landmark guided technique. And the acoustic window that is we can come from medial to lateral direction tracing the fascia iliaca as in the femoral as we do for the femoral nerve block. And the final window obtained for the block will include the sartorius muscle medially, tensor fascia latae laterally, and the rectus femoris muscle posteriorly. So this triangular area of fat pad that is squished between the sartorius and the tensor fascia latae is the area where the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve will be found, and thus the drug can be deposited. In adult patients, 5 to 10 ml of local anesthetic is usually sufficient. In children, a volume of 0.1 to 0.2 ml per kg per site would be adequate for effective analgesia. Now coming to the next block, that is the pericapsular nerve group block that was described by Giran, Arango, and Philip Peng in 2018, published in the RAPM journal. They reckoned that main innovation to the hip joint is from the femoral nerve, obturator nerve, and accessory obturator nerve, as had been reported in previous anatomical studies. But a recent study by Short et al. Grabbed their attention that said that major contribution or main articular branches to the hip joint are contributed from the femoral and accessory obturator nerve. And since these are found in the plane between the anterior inferior iliac spine and the iliopubic eminence, this detail led to their designing a new ultrasound guided method for blocking these nerves, which came to be known as the Peng block. Initially, this block was introduced as an only ultrasound-guided block. The patient is placed in supine position and a high-frequency curvilinear probe is used, as this is a deep block. This image depicts the schematic representation of the steps to follow while keeping the ultrasound probe on the thigh to acquire the desired acoustic window. Below are the ultrasound images obtained while scanning for the Peng block at different steps. Now, the first image is the step B, where the ultrasound probe is kept in a transverse fashion over the anterior superior iliac spine, and we can see the acoustic window that is shed by the bony prominence. In next step, that is C, we move the probe inferior medially along the border of the iliac bone, and until we encounter another bony prominence, that is the anterior inferior iliac spine. From here onwards, we move a slight more inferior medially and in a clockwise direction, wherein this anterior inferior iliac spine is followed by a depression, which is the superior pubic rami, followed by a bony prominence, the iliopubic eminence. In this depression lies the tendon of the iliopsoas muscle, and on the medial aspect of the acoustic window, we may also see the femoral artery. Here is a more clear image of the acoustic window. Here is a more clear image of the acoustic window obtained on ultrasound scanning of the target area, showing the trajectory of the needle from the lateral to the medial side and the accumulation of drug injected when given after hitting the bony end point. A single shot block may provide analgesia only for a limited period of time, so a continuous catheter can also be placed at the same target site between the psoas tendon and the iliopubic eminence for post-op analgesia. Drug solution of 0.1 to 0.125% bupivacaine or 0.1% ropivacaine at 6 to 8 ml per hour can be started, and patient can be pain-free without any quadriceps weakness. Utsav Acharya and Ritesh Lamsal published this case series in 2020, in which out of their experience with the Peng block, they summarized all the vital structures present along the trajectory of the needle during an in-plane approach. So if they come from laterally, the anterior inferior iliac spine may come in the trajectory. If they go from the medial to lateral direction, the femoral artery and the vein lie in the path of the trajectory, and the ureter lies in close relation to the pubic rami. But with the use of ultrasound, overall, they concluded that this is relatively safe technique. An alternate and more basic version was needed to utilize the novelty of this versatile block in peripheral setups that are technologically challenged. So Ashok Jadon et al. In 2020 August published in the Indian Journal of Anesthesia their take on the peripheral nerve stimulator guided approach to Peng block. Landmarks identified for it are the anterior superior iliac spine and the pubic tubercle. A line is drawn between the two points of the needle between the two points, and the point of needle insertion is marked 5 cm medial to the ASIS on this line. It is done as a dual mode utilizing the PNS. As is the case with ultrasound guided technique, the target for needle is the bony endpoint, that is the superior pubic rami. If along the trajectory of the needle, quadriceps contraction was noticed, then the tip of the needle is somewhere near to the femoral nerve, and thus the needle is withdrawn and reinserted 1 cm laterally on the same line. Benefits of the Peng block over other blocks were that no unexpected vital structures are there in the direct trajectory of the needle. The peripheral nerve stimulator helps in keeping away from the femoral nerve. A correct placement of the needle can be confirmed by the bony endpoint, so keeping a depth check is not an issue. And repeated aspirations is always safe from inadvertent vascular puncture or ureteric puncture, as in this case. In this article by Tran and Philip Peng in 2019, they did a cadaveric study on 15 cadavers in which they injected the dye as Peng block and then further dissected the hip joint to study its spread, and concluded, confirming the true pericapsular nature of this block, capturing the spread of dye along the course of all the articular branches of femoral, obturator, and accessory obturator nerve. Next is this article that was published in the Scandinavian Journal in 2018, in which they did a cadaveric study similar to Tran to study and prove that dye injected in the iliopsoas plane, that is between the iliopsoas muscle and the iliofemoral ligament, will cover all the articular branches, that is both high and low, of the femoral nerve, thus producing a motor sparing blockade of the hip joint from the femoral innervation, as evident from no reduced maximum force of knee extension post blockade, thus reducing the risk of falling. This came to be known as the iliopsoas plane block. The plane for this block was same as the Peng block, but the conclusions of the study included the high and low branches of only the femoral nerve. Also, there were a few limitations to the study, that sample size was too small, that is only 5 patients, and the amount of injected 5 ml was too low for an interfacial plane block, though MRI did prove the expected spread of the drug. Now, lumbar erector spinae plane block has also been recently studied for providing analgesia for hip surgeries. It was first described by Ferrero in 2016 for the treatment of thoracic neuropathic pain. Since all or majority of the studies had been done on ESP at thoracic levels, these guys, Tulgar et al., took the onus to publish a case report of a single case of 86-year-old lady undergoing left total hip replacement who was given ESP block at L4 vertebral level and GA for the surgery. They concluded that this block could be as effective as epidural, psoas compartment block, and quadratus lumborum block for hip surgeries like PHR with low risk of clinical application. Tulgar et al. Also published another article in the Journal of Clinical Anesthesia in 2019, where they elaborated the mechanism of action of how the ESP block works when given at different levels in the vertebral column. Thoracic transverse process extends up to a length of only 2 to 3 cm laterally beyond the spinous process, whereas the lumbar transverse process extends up to a length of 4 to 6 cm laterally. Thus, a thoracic erector spinae plane block acts as an extended paravertebral block, whereas lumbar erector spinae plane block acts as a psoas compartment block clinically. And this was a cadaveric study done by Carleen et al. In 2016 and published in the British Journal of Anesthesia, where they compared the spread of injected dye and nerve involvement among 3 different techniques of quadratus lumborum block, that is a QL1, 2, and 3 blocks. Their work consistently highlighted that the drug, if given as an anterior approach to QL, that is QL3, seeps through around the psoas muscle and into the paravertebral space and involves the upper lumbar spinal nerves, that is the lumbar plexus, and thus can be a good option for providing post-op analgesia in hip surgery patients. To back up this conclusion, Kokreja et al. In 2019 published an article in RAPM about their study done in 80 patients who were to undergo primary hip arthroplasty. And these were randomly divided into 2 groups, one in which pre-op QL3 block was given on the affected side in lateral decubitus before spinal anesthesia, and another control group in which no block was given other than the central neuraxial blockade. Their primary objective was to study the post-op pain scores at 12, 24, and 48 hours, and also assess the opioid consumption in first 48 hours. No study has till now been conducted in which after giving QL3, the quadriceps muscle strength has been studied as a primary objective. So potential spread of the drug to lumbar plexus still remains a fact at large to be proven, and thus it cannot be considered as an equipotent alternate to lumbar plexus block for providing hip analgesia. Although the fact that after giving lumbar plexus block in primary arthroplasty patients, through lateral or Shamrock's approach while withdrawing the needle, depositing some amount of drug in the anterior QL plane will definitely add to the quality of analgesia provided by the regional anesthesia in this patient. Coming to the latest prospect guidelines for hip surgeries that was released this year in 2021, the guidelines had been first published in 2005, later updated in 2010 also. It includes RCTs and meta-analysis that have been published between July 2010 and December 2019, assessing the post-op pain using analgesic, anesthetic, surgical, or other interventions, and were identified from 520 studies from Medline, EMBAS, and Cochrane databases. They emphasize that paracetamol, COX-2 inhibitors, and NSAIDs in perio period have a very important role to play in management of these patients. As we can see, this is a table that describes the overall recommendations for pain management in patients undergoing arthroplasty. They have given grade A level of evidence for paracetamol, NSAIDs, and dexamethasone, whereas grade D level of evidence for a single-shot fascia iliaca block or local infiltration analgesia. Dexamethasone was not recommended in the previous guidelines due to limited procedure-specific evidence. However, based on recent evidence, 8 to 10 milligrams of dexamethasone IV has been recommended. This is another table that has been published in the same guidelines, telling about the analgesic interventions that are not recommended. And as we can see, the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, anterior QL block, femoral nerve block, lumbar plexus block, local infiltration anesthesia, analgesia infusion or repeated injections, and epidural analgesia are among those that are not recommended, probably due to the limited procedure-specific evidence or procedure-specific evidence is available, but they are with side effects. About peripheral nerve blocks, single-shot peripheral nerve block have previously been recommended by the prospect group. Recently, 26 new studies were available, and the interventions studied in them were included the femoral nerve block, lumbar plexus block, psoas compartment block, fascia iliaca, lateral femoral cutaneous, and the anterior QL block. In conclusion, they said that the femoral, lumbar plexus, psoas compartment, QL, and fascia iliaca lowered post-op pain and morphine consumption, whereas lateral femoral cutaneous nerve solely did not. The lumbar plexus block is a deep block with potential risk, and the femoral nerve block has a significant incidence of muscle weakness, thus not recommended. And in recent meta-analysis, no more faults were reported with fascia iliaca block. Thus, it was recommended as a preferred nerve block when a nerve block is indicated for arthroplasty. But then there are also articles like these by Memsudis et al., published in the August issue of RAPM Journal this year, which brings into light the evidence-based international expert consensus after assessing RCTs and observational studies done in last half century, 50 years, regarding the impact of the use of peripheral nerve blocks in arthroplasty surgeries. They brought forth a more elaborate answer to questions like, does the use of peripheral nerve block influence post-op complications in patients undergoing total knee arthroplasty? They said that the use of peripheral nerve blocks was associated with significantly decreased odds for numerous major post-op complications. And then also put forth a recommendation of evidence level moderate to strong that peripheral nerve blocks for perioperative management should be considered for arthroplasties when there is no contraindication. So after studying all these RA techniques for providing hip analgesia and anesthesia, if we have to make a choice of any one particular block, we cannot, as there is no single intervention that will provide complete anesthesia and analgesia owing to the complex multiple innovations of the hip joint. There will always be a combination of RA techniques, and multiple factors will have to be considered for making this choice. First and foremost, it must be patient-specific. It will depend on certain patient factors like the age of the patient, associated comorbidities, ongoing medications. Then there will be procedure-specific factors which will block, like which block will be preferred for preoperative analgesia or as an on-arrival block or when it is being given for patient positioning, and then which ones will be preferred for post-op analgesia. Then whether it's a primary surgery or a redo surgery, and whether muscle or tissue dissection is going to be done or not, as in cases of redo surgeries. And last but not the least, what is the incision that will be taken by the surgeon? This will tell which dermatomes and myotomes need to be covered. So tailored anesthesia, that is site-specific, loco-regional, opioid-sparing, and multimodal, keeping all the patients and procedure-specific factors in mind, is the way to go. To conclude, I would here like to give an example of combination of blocks for hip analgesia, where in 2019, Dr. Ritesh Roy published a case series in RFM journal where they gave pain block for post-op analgesia in 5 patients who underwent primary hip arthroplasty. Few of these complained of pain over the dermatomal area of the skin incision post-operatively. So they improvised their plan and gave pain block with LFC in block in next 5 patients and achieved complete hip analgesia for 48 hours of post-op period. Sorry, I have not mentioned about local infiltration analgesia in this, but I'll still like to mention that literature says that obviously local infiltration cannot be compared to any the analgesia provided by any of these blocks, but it does reduce the overall opioid consumption in the first 48 hours. Thank you.
Thank you, Ankit.
Thank you, sir.
I think a lot of literature review and block techniques, and we thought of, you know, giving some good literature evidence so that everyone can add to their, how we can scientifically look at a given technique. And being a regional anesthesia fellow, it is I think mandatory nowadays that you should look into recent evidence, and that's what I was emphasizing to my fellows. So I'm happy they looked at the articles and blocks. Yes, they have picked up all the blocks. The presentation, I was trying to convince them to generate more photos and videos, but partly they have done, partly they have not done. It's next time I think we'll improve on that. So over to other faculties for their inputs and questions. Ankit, you can stop your presentation. Okay, I'll start with the first question. I think to all, mainly to Ankit, Namrata, because they have described all the block techniques and all that. So Namrata, what is your choice of hip analgesia? What is your favorite recipe and why?
So there is no specific recipe like Ankit described for any hip surgery. You have to see the patient characteristic. We have to see what is the surgical incision, and a combination of approaches have to be used. So there is no one single block which will cover everything. Also, lumbar sacral plexus block, though it covers the entire unilateral limb, it cannot be given, and it should not be given for each and every patient. It should be tailored according to the patient need. So there are combinations like Ankit said, PENG plus lateral femoral cutaneous probably will cover majority of the cutaneous and muscular innervation. As well, the subpectinal obturator plus supraimanal fascia alaca will do the same coverage of the for the analgesia for hip surgeries, is what I think. But there is no one recipe, single.
Okay. Ankit, what are your thoughts? Ankit?
Sir, it'll completely depend on certain factors to be considered, like age of the patient, the comorbidities that are associated in this patient. And since most of the arthroplasty we deal with are octogenarian patients, so they will have some of the other cardiac issues. So yes, regional anesthesia is the technique of choice for giving anesthesia to these patients. If it's a primary arthroplasty, I may go with a preoperative fascia iliaca compartment block and put a catheter too for acquiring post-op analgesia. But if it is a redo surgery or extensive adhesiolysis is to be done, in which we want a good muscle paralysis, so I would like to go with lumbar plexus and sacral plexus block. And another advantage that I'll have in this choice will be that it will also provide a good post op analgesia, not just for the anterior capsule, but it will include the posterior capsule analgesia as well.
All right. So we have many other faculties here. So Hetal, yeah. Hetal, you are not audible.
No, Ramit, shall I go with my question?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, Murli here. A question to all the candidates here. Now, you know, the entire class was about hip analgesia. So what would be your choice if the patient comes to the emergency room and they request analgesia? Any one of you can take the question.
Sir, the most easier of all the blocks to perform as on arrival block would be a femoral nerve block. And I would put the supraingual fascia lacerator block second to it, because it is a little more skillful compared to the femoral nerve block.
Why not just the standard fascia lacerator block? See, the reason why I'm asking is not every emergency room will have an ultrasound. Now, I know in Ruby Hall you are using ultrasound for more or less everything now. But we are talking in terms of, all the other fellows who are here, we might not be able to get the ultrasound due to emergency. So what would you recommend in that situation?
So no doubt, if we are not having an ultrasound, I would like to go with a peripheral nerve stimulator or maybe a landmark guided fascia iliacal compartment block, because it will involve more of the articular branches to the hip joint from the other nerves as well, the obturator or the accessory obturator nerve. A femoral nerve block will give analgesia only from the articular branches of the femoral nerve block.
If you have an ultrasound, you say your first choice would be femoral nerve block.
No, so with the ultrasound, if I do not have much time and the patient is extensively wincing in pain, then maybe a femoral nerve block, yes, because it is easier to perform and it is less time consuming. But if in the hands of a skilled regional anesthetist, even a supraingual fascia iliacal compartment block will be a good option.
Why not a pen block? Because as you, I think one of the speakers mentioned, it's a safe block, yes, right? And so why not a pen block? Any disadvantage there?
Sir, not exactly a disadvantage, but as far as I have read in the literature about experiences of various stalwarts who are experts in giving pain block, they say that the quality of analgesia is short-lived as compared to the fascia iliacal compartment block. And one more thing that I would like to mention here, sir, that Dr. Philip Peng himself, in one of the webinars that was recently done 2 months back, he mentioned that there is a iliopectineal bursa that lies between the bony endpoint and the iliopectineous muscle. So he mentioned that just hitting the bony endpoint is not the final stage for injecting the drug, because the drug may just get accumulated in the bursa and it may not give a complete or a good quality analgesia. So he added one step himself in that webinar, that after hitting the bony endpoint, they need to turn the needle 180 degrees so that we're just confirmed that the drug gets accumulated over the bony in the bony plane.
Okay.
So such small details are very important if we are talking about the differences between pain block and the other blocks.
And what about the volume that you would use in a pain block?
Sir, around 30 to 40 ml of the injected, maybe 2.2% ropivacaine if you are only going for the analgesia for.
Okay. See, I will limit myself to the analgesia on arrival. Is there any role of a hematoma which can form here in your block effect? See, you do get hematoma in fractured hip, and it'll, the anatomy is a little bit different from a person whom you are actually giving a femoral nerve block for a knee replacement or a hip replacement, right? So is there any role of the hematoma affecting your block in such cases?
Sir, it can limit the spread of the drug more proximally. Is one
do you do on arrival blocks?
Not so much, but yes, we have done.
You have done. Okay. And what would you use as a choice if you were to sit this patient up for a spinal?
Sir, in that case, a femoral nerve block itself, because major contribution of articular branches is from the femoral nerve. So we would give an unravel femoral nerve block if we need to position the patient.
Okay.
And some very mild sedation to make it a complete multimodal analgesia.
And do you practice perineural catheters at all for on arrival?
Yes, sir, we have done.
Okay. I think I'll let Dr. Hetal take over.
Am I audible now? Amit?
Yeah. Please.
Yeah. So my question is to Namrata. Namrata, do you give lumbar plexus block and sacral plexus block awake or is it with GA? And second question is it ultrasound guided, PNS guided, or is it dual technique?
Good evening, sir. Sir, we give lumbar plexus and sacral plexus block in hip surgery, especially only to those indicated patients in whom central neuraxial blockade is not possible or it is to be avoided, it is to be contraindicated. So we don't routinely give lumbar sacral plexus block to the hip surgeries. And we use USG as well as PNS, dual mode assistance, for the lumbar and sacral plexus block in the special patients in whom we just want unilateral limb blockade and unilateral sympathectomy rather than the sympathetic blockade caused by central neuraxial block.
Good. Another question is when you are giving lumbar plexus block, there are chances of subarachnoid space or epidural spray or intravascular injection. So how you prevent it?
So the pressure during the injection pressure should be always less than 15 PSI because the large pressure.
I am asking about
intravascular. Yeah. So it will, if we are injecting it with high pressure, it could spread intrathecally or epidurally. If we are frequent aspirations and lesser pressure during the injection should be practiced.
Hetal has pointed out
rightly. So important,
we disconnect the syringe from the before injecting, and we wait patiently. If we see any liquid coming, then we are very suspicious. It could be CSF. So we have to be very careful with the first injection because CSF is difficult to pick up. We can always pick up blood very quickly with negative aspiration, but CSF can be tricky. So we have to wait and be very suspicious about it. Look at the parameters. You can have fragmented drug instillation so that you can wait for its action to affect hemodynamics. So do it very gently and slowly. Take your own time because patient may crash with such large volume of drug. Yeah, over to it.
So always keep your needle end open while locating the plexus so that in case if you are intravascular or intrathecal, you will get CSF or blood flow and you will save yourself and your patient.
Yes, sir.
Next question is, you told me that you are giving a lumbar plexus, sacral plexus in high-risk patient. So suppose you are getting a patient with 25 or 30% EF, patient can't tolerate hypotension. So what will you prefer, graded epidural or lumbar plexus?
Lumbar plexus, sir.
Why so?
Because the hypertension caused by epidural won't be compensated by the patient, whereas here in lumbar plexus there are very less chances of causing hypertension.
I will like to correct you that even with lumbar plexus there are chances of hypotension, isn't it so?
Yes, sir.
So what will you prefer? So what will your plan of anesthesia with such patient? Will you give lumbar plexus, GA, epidural, or anything else?
So definitely, the patients who cannot tolerate hypotension, I would still like to go with lumbar plexus because epidural causing hypotension won't be compensated, whereas with lumbar plexus, I will put the catheter and I will grade the, I will give the infusion or in tritated doses.
Okay, that is a better idea.
See, when you are asked with this type of question, you have to frame your answers taking into account, because there is nothing like, as everyone has mentioned in their presentation, that there is no single recipe. So if you are comparing a level one block like epidural, lumbar epidural, versus a lumbar and sacral plexus block, which are level three blocks. So level one block is always, even all the Cochrane database, all the comparisons, we have good amount of evidence and people have used it so since so long that they can achieve that desired effect of, you know, graded epidural and without causing hypotension. So nothing wrong about graded epidural, or some people do unilateral spinal and things like that. But we are in the era of site-specific anesthesia analgesia. And when one limb can be blocked only, why not go for that? Why to block the other limb is the question. And with advancement with our technical know-how, the sonoanatomy knowledge and needling skills have improved, we can definitely achieve that desired effect. And nothing is free from risk. So we have to be very much ready for all these. So even with these high-risk patients, when we do, we explain everything. We explain it to the patient, patient relative, surgeon, even the nursing staff, that the other limb is not blocked, so they cannot put the equipments very heavily on that limb and things like that. And we do all monitoring. These are patients with art line, central line, even the pacemaker and the external paddles attached. So everything is ready for plan B as general anesthesia. And then we, in a controlled environment, there is always an additional consultant to help. And even the last preparation, dose calculation, everything. And then we do it. And probably we found that doing this way, the patients are getting benefited and they can be fast-tracked from OT and ICU. But regional anesthesia, it means you have to think about the patient first, the overall safety, and whether the technique is safe in your hand, how much you have experience in doing that technique, and do not hesitate to ask for help. So high-risk patient means lumbar plexus block, that is not the answer. You have to outweigh risk. Yeah. All right.
Even simple technique, like you can give fascia-iliac compartment block, you put an LMA and you can put keep the patient on spontaneous respiration, and you can do this case in any setup. You don't require any ultrasound or any hi-fi machines to manage this patient. So you can manage this patient with LMA and fascia-iliac compartment block. So there are many techniques, as said by Amit. Over to other faculties.
Amit, can I add?
Yeah, please, Azam.
Yeah, Ankit, I think in reference to Murli's question, he was quite clear in asking ki, if honorable blocks, which one would you give? That's fine. Femoral nerve block is correct. But what was the idea behind of giving a femoral nerve block? Any specific reason that you chose over?
Sir, it will paralyze that limb, and the whole idea of that the patient is not bothered about his limb being mobilized by any paramedical staff that can cause pain. They are already in so much pain that even the thought of the limb being moved may cause pain to them. So that is where that limb, that the limb will be absolutely immobilized, and also it will provide analgesia.
Correct. So to add on to that, whenever you're giving a femoral nerve block, or whenever a patient has a fracture, the muscles also contribute a great extent to the pain. So yes, you want the muscles also to get relaxed. Probably by giving a femoral nerve block rather than giving a pang block or any other block would definitely, I think, help. And other thing is, somebody was talking about pang block. What does the literature say, that what is your right way of placing your probe? How do you know your probe is in the right place?
So we have two brony prominences, that the anterior inferior iliac spine and the iliopubic eminence, and a depression or a crest in between them, that is the superior upper border of the superior pubic rami, and in this depression lies the tendon of the iliopsoas muscle. So the needle is advanced from the lateral to medial aspect from the side of the anterior inferior iliac spine, and it goes and hits the bony endpoint, that is the superior pubic rami, and the drug is injected below the tendon of the iliopsoas and the bony plane.
Correct. To add on to that, I think Philip Peng himself says, when you're placing the probe, you angle it towards the femoral head. Once you angle it towards the femoral head, you see the femoral head there and you come back to the normal position, and then you know that you're in the right plane, and then go ahead with the block. Right. Excellent presentation. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, I must confess that some of the answers by my fellows are biased with the institutional practice. So I am very well aware that there are diverse practices and nothing wrong about upcoming Peng block as an honorable block. And when we are in the era of fast tracking and eras, also the lumbar and sacral plexus block versus fascia iliaca. So most of the thought process probably is biased by our institutional practices. So whenever these type of questions are asked, you have to be little unbiased and be open to discussion, because there are different ways of managing the same case. Now here I would like to give all the fellows the rationale of choosing any block. So what you have already gone through, or you have seen all the blocks, you are aware of the osteotome, myotome, dermatome, everything. So here you have to understand that there are basically the incision is different, which is most commonly the covered by lateral femoral cutaneous nerve. So the incision pain is from a different source altogether. When we talk of intraoperative pain, it is mainly the anterior hip capsule and all that. So as you know, the role of articular branches of femoral, obturator, accessory obturator. So we have supra-inguinal, fascia iliaca, we have Peng and things like that to cover the intraoperative part. Now there is another third aspect which Azam has highlighted, the involvement of muscle group. So major surgeries, redo surgeries, where there is muscle cutting, then probably only these Peng and muscle sparing blocks may not help. So you need a muscle paralyzing block also when it is a redo surgery and things like that. So they probably then we require all those dedicated subpectineal obturator nerve block or a high femoral, and we need to paralyze them as well to some extent. So when we are choosing the recipe, we should be aware that the skin incision, we have two options, probably a lateral femoral cutaneous or a local infiltration analgesia. Intraoperative, mainly it is anterior hip capsule for most of the surgeries. So we have different supra-inguinal fascia iliaca along with subpectineal obturator with Peng and things like that. And if it is muscle cutting, then probably we have to think of other higher strategies like lumbar plexus and all that. So depending on your comfort, your institutional practice, your own expertise, availability, resources, and how much surgeon will allow you, and other factors, you can choose. So this is how you can change your practice, be introspective, look at the literature review, and I think we can achieve that. We still have other faculties. Please, Javed sir was also there. Sir, you want to ask anything?
Hello, Amit.
Yes, sir.
Audible?
Yeah. You're
not, not much of question to the youngsters, but some suggestions like this. There has to be a distinct distinction between on arrival blocks and blocks for conducting surgery. So if it's on arrival block, most of the surgeons, they want to assess a neurological deficit or something like that. So femoral block in that condition may not be appropriate. Most of the orthopedic surgeon doesn't happy with this femoral block. So in that case, my suggestion is a fascia iliaca block or supra-inguinal, any of the variety will do as far as analgesia is concerned. But if you are having a procedure, for that matter, hip arthroplasty, we need to have higher block, definitely a lumbosacral plexus block. Though it has been mentioned as advanced level block, but to me, it's not any difficult task. And what has been Hital bhai describing about, I too agree with that. a slow sequential injection of drug. See, if I want to produce a unilateral or bilateral epidural block with lumbar plexus, I can easily do that with a rapid injection of drug with a high concentration. The crux of this block is always that they use a low concentration of drug and a slow every 2 ml stop, aspirate, then proceed. And definitely, it will lead to less of the unilateral epidural. Likewise, your suggestion, Amit.
Yeah. What you are mentioning is perfectly right. Probably the on-arrival femoral block is this is what initially I picked up in Ganga when I was doing my fellowship. And probably we do not have that much of volume for hip. So more or less, this practice is even continuing with my institute. But I take up your suggestion. It is perfectly fine. We should move on to and try with the on-arrival supra-inguinal fascia iliaca or a PENG or these blocks. Sometimes we are using these blocks. It is when we are doing this surgery under spinal anesthesia and we have no plan to put epidural, but we are worried whether our surgeon will finish the surgery in spinal time or not. So in that case, we do this femoral block and a subpectineal obturator nerve block. And it causes good amount of paralysis around the joint. And even if the spinal time has reached and we are in that gray zone area where probably should we go ahead with GA or they will finish. So this little bit time we do get when we combine subpectineal obturator with femoral and can get away with these cases when we have not placed an epidural. This we have tried, and but yes, there are different ways of looking at it, and we can use in a better way. If you have done a block for making the patient sit, then you have already invested with local anesthetic. So now you have limited local anesthesia to do and perform other blocks. So first block you have to choose wisely, because then you have to play with the combination with other blocks. So if you have done a PENG first and then lateral femoral cutaneous, that is good idea, or a supra-inguinal fascia iliaca with subpectineal obturator, that is also fine. So in a way, local anesthesia systemic toxicity, always put Doppler and see the blood vessels, inject very carefully. And these are the patients who are critically ill, and so they are very prone for local anesthesia systemic toxicity. We have to be careful. And as Javed sir rightly pointed out, we are in the era of medico-legal awareness, and very common discussion happens after a hip surgery that patient has developed some focal neurological deficit, patient has either foot drop or patient has some tingling numbness and things like that. So we have to be very careful while choosing our block strategy. So pre-op neurological assessment is crucial, even if patients are in pain, and we must document it before doing any block. Yeah.
One more session for youngsters. Yes. If you are not doing a higher block, lumbar sacral plexus, if you are doing individual femoral LFCN, then they should always combine with obturator, because most of the cases are done for orthopedic purposes. So tourniquet application is a must. So correct. For that, obturator has to have blocked obturator. Beware of that obturator. If we are blocking individual nerve, obturator should be included all the time. Am I right, Amit?
Yeah. Yes, you lumbar plexus and sacral plexus block always, mainly the lumbar plexus comes to my mind when they are talking about tourniquet part. Yes. Thank you. I also see Koppad sir and Ramamurthy and other. So thank you, Javed sir. The innervation should be very much, we must be aware of it. And planning of tourniquet should be discussed beforehand. Otherwise, it is very difficult intraoperatively. Usually, if we do not give we do not cover that posterior cutaneous nerve, especially the sciatic component, It can also be tricky. After half an hour, I have done these cases with sciatic and femoral block, and after usually half an hour, they start complaining of pain. And then maybe sub-anesthetic ketamine dose may be helpful for another 10-15 minutes, but it becomes very tricky. So off late, we are using high-level block like lumbar plexus block and sacral plexus when we are have to do this tourniquet. I hope I have mentioned it, my logic in doing it. There may be other ways of looking at it. So, Koppad sir, Dr. Ramamurthy. Yeah.
Good evening, Amit. Good evening, everyone.
Yeah.
Amit, have you used plexus blocks, particularly lumbar plexus and sacral plexus, as sole anesthetics for hip arthroplasties?
Yes, sir.
And what is your how often you have used, and what is your experience?
We even done it in last week as well, and somehow because we are doing it, so we have got polarized work, and surgeons are referring patients to our hospital. I am aware you are also doing this lumbar plexus block from quite some time, and this is always a block. And we do all the preparations and we explain everything, and we do not sell lumbar plexus and sacral plexus block, but our surgeons and patients purchase it. I mean, we do not promote it that way, because we tell them all the advantages and disadvantages, and when they agree to everything what we say, then we proceed with this block. And we were fortunate, whatever, like up to in last 4-5 years, we have done around 15-20 cases. We were fortunate enough that we have not seen that spectrum of complication. But yes, every block teaches us something new. And we have reached a good combination of ultrasound and PNS for using this block.
At some point, there was a discussion about neuraxial blocks, hemodynamic disturbances, and also your lumbar plexus and sacral plexus block, and relative sympatholysis. We have seen, we have probably close to 1,000 lumbar plexus and sacral plexus blocks in our clinical experience. The kind of hemodynamic stability we see in relation to neuraxial blocks is actually you have to perform to witness it. At some point there was a debate, Dr. Hethel was mentioning, you do encounter hypotension even with lumbar plexus. I think it is very rare and it is very safe. And as most of the hip arthroplasties we deal with, very fragile, old, multiple comorbid patients, I'm sure over the time, the role of lumbar plexus and sacral plexus, and also the particularly the youngsters to really learn, train, and pick up the skill of these advanced blocks take us a long way in offering safe sole anesthetic for hip arthroplasties.
Yes, sir, I agree to that. Most of these patients, as we are doing this lumbar and sacral plexus block for high-risk patients, somehow we start with the, because they are critically ill from heart point of view, most often we end up with starting off a small dash of NORAD from the beginning, maybe 1 or 2 mL, light concern. So little dash of NORAD, and we start with the failure management. So maybe titrated Lasix has gone in initially itself. So whatever fluid we are giving, we are very meticulously following it, and blood to be replaced by blood. So, yes, what you are mentioning is true. Not much of hypotension was a problem. More or less, our BP always was, even with very minimal or absolutely just a very small touch, it always stays around 140, and we never had. But sometimes some patients, after doing a lumbar plexus block, once or twice we had one reading lower down or something like that. We don't know exactly, but it was never been that much of a problem. I agree to that.
It was very exhaustive and a very elaborate presentation, Sami. And probably the kind of choices actually we witnessed from today's presentation inevitably leads us into confusion, what actually we need to practice. And probably also it expands our understanding and also the list of options what we have. It has both merits and demerits. Thank you very much once again.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Anybody wants to say anything or we shall close?
Dr. Amit, can I say a word?
Yeah, please, Dr. Amurthy.
Yeah. One more thing regarding the supra-inguinal fascia area block is that there are some recent studies where in RIPM journal where they found that supra-inguinal fascia iliaca block may not always cover the obturator. So that's one thing we always keep in mind. And if your aim is to block the obturator nerve for the analgesia purpose. The second thing is that the minimum effective volume for the supra-inguinal fascia iliaca block to cover the obturator nerve is 60 ml. That was found in one of the studies. So again, if you are aiming to block the obturator nerve as a main thing in a fascia iliaca block, so that thing has to be kept in mind. So if you want to just block only the femoral nerve block, you just go ahead and block the femoral nerve directly and not go for the fascia iliaca block. Is that one thing I want to say? And second thing is always add other analgesics, not just go directly for the block. You should add the oral or IV analgesics like paracetamol, a small dose of opioid or an NSAID, if not contraindicated, whenever the patient is in ER, before going to take the needle and just block the patient.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Ramamurthy.
Thank you.
So we tried covering good amount of literature review as well with today's discussion. And definitely the purpose of stimulating all our fellows to read more of journals and articles is served. And we should have this type of competitive spirit amongst our RA fellows as well. And they must see few standard literature evidence as well. Thank you very much. I think we'll close now. Thank you very much once again. I'm happy with the presentation part and the discussion. And thank you all faculties for your valuable contribution. Thank you all fellows for joining.
Thank you, Amit.
Thank you.